Traditionally, there's rhythm that we're taught, you know, that are played. If there's a wedding, you play this. If there's a funeral, you play this. If there's a marriage, or if there's the full moon. So for starters, you learn the traditional rhythms. You learn, okay, one is three sounds, so you got bass, tone, slap. From that, then you start learning rhythms within context of the bass, tone, slap. Once you become really aware of what these rhythms are, now you can then reverse them, or you can, you know, embellish on these rhythms and make them your own. So that's what happens over time. I mean, the more and more I'm just, you know, honing the craft and taking these rhythms that I learned from a young age, that I've, you know, from studying and just from traveling, just from just hearing, and just making it my own. So these rhythms, yeah, maybe they do just pop up in my head. I mean, just walking down the street is a rhythm. You create that rhythm. So if I'm just in stride sometimes, I sing on top of that. And then I can take that, and then now when I sit down at my instrument, those same rhythms that I was kind of just going through just on a basic walking down the street, it becomes now something melodic.
I am Rasan Elijah Talu Green. I'm an artist slash drummer from Brooklyn, New York.
The instrument itself is a spiritual instrument as well. So a lot of times these rhythms you're connecting with is on the spiritual side, is beyond the physical. So what you're getting, you're seeing, okay, oh, he's hitting this and he's playing all this fast stuff. But spiritually, it's beyond that. I'm dealing with this, or this spirit, if depending on the dance that we're doing or rhythm that's being played, you're invoking certain spirits, and that's what comes through you as, or me per se, and that's what's going on when I'm playing and when I'm really into that groove and in that zone. That's what's really going on, and so that's where those rhythms come from, and they're there. My father back in the late 70s, he sought out to start his own community-based situation called the Crown Heights Youth Collective. And through that, it was just a bridge in the gap between, you know, the West Indians, the Hasidic Jews, and just the overall community. I grew up in that scheme of things. You know, where it really became prominent is in 91, the Crown Heights crises, the riots between the blacks and the Jews. He was the guy, you know, he brokered the deal between them and, you know, kind of brought them together, trying to unify it as a community, because the Crown Heights, you know, granted it was split, they tried to split it up, but he sat there, he said, no, well, this is one community. So he started the whole, you know, increase the peace, he started these peace games, just different things, just unifying the blacks and the whites and just making them a stronger community. And to this day, he's still recognized for those works that he's done. And, you know, it's just about 40 years now.
One thing, the thing about us as a people, we have to be able to identify, create, and support the people who will come in our place. Pass that baton on to that next individual. And that's what these programs are all about, is baton passing. We're looking at this program now with the idea of Jesse Owens. When Jesse Owens came, in one day, 2 hours, he must have broke four world records. But one of the records he broke was that relay race, and that was the signal that we have to keep passing it on.
Right, left. 5, 6.
Well, you know, it's just important, and I mean, the more and more is just what you're leaving behind and how, you know, at the end of the day, what your legacy is. And the legacy is passing on information that, you know, is given to you. If you leave here today and everything that you know is just within you, then what's the point of it? And so that's why as much as I still love to teach, I still, even if I have one student, or if I have 100 students, I still love that, because I think it's important just to know, like, you know, folks care, folks want to share, folks, there's things that folks want to give to you. And as long as you're receptive, you know, just able to just move on like that. The director of the Arts and Ed program from Creative Outlet just randomly sends me an email, and this email was the casting call for this new workshop. This description read, you know, just looking for a male musician athletic, maybe that can, you know, dance, move a little bit. And that was kind of, oh, let me go in here and let me try this out. Never auditioned in my life. I didn't have a professional headshot. I didn't have a resume drafted. It was just, I knew what I can do. Everything I've done prior to this moment was just, oh, people call me. Oh, they want to use me for this. They want to use me for that. So I showed up that morning to the casting call, just my drum and me. This was the workshop phase. So the show wasn't what it was or what it is today in that moment, but just in those workshop phase. So they worked through it. And Bill T. Jones, the choreographer director, so he's like, okay, we're gonna bring you in. We're not sure how we're gonna use you, but we know we want you and we're gonna utilize you to the best of our ability. My preparation for Fela is very intense in the sense of, I mean, you can't just do the show. Yeah, the show is, you know, you exert energy, but you have to get into that show. You have to be able to do the show because 2.5 hours is a long time and it's pushing. It's a concert for me. It's not, like, the show wasn't made for musical theater. Like, it wasn't your average Broadway show, no. We was kind of like set a precedent doing that show. It came to a point where you do the show so much, it becomes, you know, it's the second nature. It becomes like the back of your hand. When my mom was pregnant with me, about 7 months pregnant, her and my father took a trip over to West Africa. One of the elders in the village told my mom if she tapped a 6-8 rhythm, which is a you tap that 6-8 rhythm on the unborn womb, your child will come out some sort of something music related, something musically inclined. And she just tried it, not thinking of anything beyond it. And before I could even walk, probably about 9 months, I got my first djembe. It's a little baby djembe, and I used to, you know, I would play with it in my playpen. I couldn't even stand up, but that was, you know, something that I just kind of got into it from birth. I would just always be tapping. You know, I grew into it. That's kind of been how I grew up, and just it's taken me, and, you know, just more and more. You never forget where you come from, and a lot of times, like, I traveled a lot. I've traveled places, and I've been able to share, and it's like, without knowing my home base and knowing where I've come from, those other opportunities probably would have never come.